Hello children, welcome to online classes. Today we will discuss important points in environmental chemistry. Environmental chemistry deals with the pollution in atmosphere. An atmosphere consists of the following spheres. So the first one is called troposphere, then comes stratosphere, then comes mesosphere, then comes thermosphere. So let us see the extent of these four spheres and the components which are present in that, as well as a variation of the temperature. Now from 0 to 11 kilometers approximately, the lower part, 0 to 11 kilometers, we have troposphere. The troposphere consists of N2, O2, CO2 and water vapor. So 0 to 11 kilometers is called troposphere. Troposphere consists of nitrogen, oxygen, carbon dioxide, water vapor. And then if you see the temperature variation, temperature is varying from 15 degrees Celsius to minus here 56 degrees Celsius. Temperature variation is 15 degrees to minus 56 degrees Celsius we have approximately in troposphere. So it is 0 to 11 kilometers troposphere, consists of N2, O2, CO2, H2O vapor, and temperature is ranging from 15 to minus 56 degrees Celsius. The second one is called stratosphere. It is ranging from 11 kilometers to 50 kilometers. Ranging from 11 kilometers to 50 kilometers, that is called stratosphere. And stratosphere mainly contains nitrogen, oxygen, ozone and oxygen atoms. Nitrogen, oxygen, ozone and oxygen atoms are there in the stratosphere. And stratosphere temperature is ranging from minus 56 degrees Celsius to minus 2 degrees Celsius. It is ranging from minus 56 here to nearly it is minus we have 2 degrees Celsius we have. This range of temperature now. The third one comes out to be mesosphere. Mesosphere, it is ranging from 50 kilometers to 85 kilometers. Mesosphere is ranging from 50 kilometers to 85 kilometers we have, 85 kilometers. And the mesosphere consists of nitrogen, oxygen, and O2 plus and NO plus ions in that. So mesosphere contains N2, O2 and O2 plus and NO plus ions are there. And then coming towards temperature, that is ranging from minus 2 degrees to minus 90 degrees Celsius we have. It is from minus 2 degrees Celsius here to it is coming up to minus 92 degrees we have. That is the range of mesosphere we have. Then finally it comes out to be a thermosphere. Thermosphere, it is ranging from, thermosphere is ranging from, means we can say from, it is 85 kilometers to 500 kilometers range we have. From 85 to 500 kilometers range, that is called thermosphere. And thermosphere mainly contains O2 plus, O plus, NO plus and free electrons in that. O2 plus, O plus, NO plus and free electrons are there in thermosphere. And thermosphere temperature is ranging from minus 92 degrees Celsius to 1200 degrees Celsius we have. It is ranging from minus 92 to 1200 degrees Celsius we have. That is called thermosphere. So atmosphere mainly consists of four segments, or we can say four spheres. The first one troposphere, second one stratosphere, third one mesosphere, and fourth one is called thermosphere. This is regarding the various segments which are present in the atmosphere. Then the atmospheric pollution generally studied as a tropospheric and a stratospheric pollution. It's mainly studied as a tropospheric and then stratospheric pollution. The following are major gaseous and particulate pollutants present in the troposphere. So we have the major gaseous and particulate pollutants present in the troposphere. Let us see first of all gaseous pollutants. The gaseous air pollutants, these are oxides of sulfur, nitrogen, carbon and hydrogen sulfide, hydrocarbons, ozone and other oxidants we have. The gaseous air pollutants in troposphere are oxides of sulfur, oxides of nitrogen, oxides of carbon, hydrogen sulfide gas, hydrocarbons, ozone, other oxidants are there. When it comes to particulate pollutants, these are dust, mist, fumes, smoke, smog. So when it comes to particulate pollutants, there are dust, mist, fumes, smoke and smog we have. These are the various pollutants present in the troposphere. Next one. Now let us take one by one the gaseous air pollutants. First one, oxides of sulfur. Now the most common species is sulfur dioxide. It is a gas that is a poisonous to both animals as well as plants. So the oxides of sulfur, the most common species, sulfur dioxide is a gas that is a poisonous to both animals as well as plants. The low concentration of sulfur dioxide causes respiratory diseases, that is asthma, bronchitis in human beings. If you take low concentration of sulfur dioxide, it is causing respiratory diseases such as asthma, bronchitis in human beings. It also causes irritation to the eyes, resulting in tears as well as redness of the eyes. It also causes irritation to the eyes, resulting in the tears as well as redness. Then, if you take higher concentration of sulfur dioxide, that leads to stiffness of flower buds, which eventually fall off from the plants. Higher concentration of sulfur dioxide leads to stiffness of flower buds, which eventually fall off from the plants. The particulate matter in polluted air catalyzes the oxidation of sulfur dioxide to further sulfur trioxide also. The particulate matter in polluted air catalyzes the oxidation of sulfur dioxide to even sulfur trioxide also. That is to say here, the sulfur trioxide in the presence of moisture, so SO3, presence of moisture, it forms H2SO4, which is acidic in nature, and this starts attacking marble, limestone, vegetation, paper and textiles here. Sulfur trioxide in presence of moisture forms H2SO4, which is highly acidic in nature, and this starts attacking the marble, limestone, vegetation, paper, textile, etc. This is regarding the pollutant sulfur dioxide. Next one, the oxides of nitrogen. Atmosphere mainly contains O2 and then N2. They do not combine at normal temperature conditions. So atmosphere consists of N2 and O2, but they are not reacting under normal conditions. During lightning, nitrogen and oxygen combine at higher altitudes and form nitric oxide. So during lightning, they combine to form nitric oxide. Now, so here nitrogen plus oxygen at high temperature, nearly it is 1483 Kelvin, at high temperature, this forms nitric oxide. Nitric oxide further gets oxidized in the atmospheric oxygen. It forms their nitrogen dioxide we have known. So nitrogen and oxygen combine in an automobile engine at high temperature to form nitric oxide. So along with the atmospheric nitrogen and oxygen, even in automobile's engine at high temperature also, formation of nitric oxide takes place now. Nitric oxide reacts with oxygen to form nitrogen dioxide. Further, NO reacts with oxygen forming nitrogen dioxide. Higher concentrations of NO2 damage leaves of plants and retard the rate of photosynthesis. The higher concentrations of NO2 damage the leaves of plants and even retard the rate of photosynthesis. This is regarding oxides of nitrogen. Then NO2 is even a lung irritant and then cause and can lead to respiratory diseases in children. NO2 is a lung irritant and can lead to respiratory disease in children. It is also toxic to the living tissues and is also carcinogenic in nature, means cancer causing compound. So NO2 is a lung irritant and can lead to respiratory disease in children. It is a toxic to tissues. It is also carcinogenic. Then the oxides of carbon. The oxides of carbon we have. Carbon monoxide is a dangerous air pollutant we have. Carbon monoxide is a dangerous air pollutant. It is colorless, odorless, highly poisonous to living beings. Colorless, odorless and highly poisonous to living beings now. Carbon monoxide is released into the air by automobile exhaust. Released in the air by automobile exhaust. It is also formed by incomplete combustion of coal, firewood, petrol. It is formed by incomplete combustion of coal, firewood, petrol. Carbon monoxide combines with the hemoglobin and forms carboxyhemoglobin complex. CO combines with hemoglobin of the blood and forms carboxyhemoglobin. This carboxyhemoglobin is a stable complex when compared to oxygen hemoglobin. It is more stable than oxyhemoglobin complex. If the concentration of carboxyhemoglobin in the blood, if it reaches to 3 to 4%, blood cannot carry oxygen effectively. If carboxyhemoglobin in the blood reaches to 3 to 4%, blood cannot carry oxygen effectively. The oxygen deficiency results in headache, weak eyesight, nervousness, and cardiovascular disorder. So the oxygen deficiency results in headache, weak eyesight, nervousness, and cardiovascular disorder. It's all because of carboxyhemoglobin. Then carbon dioxide is released into atmosphere by respiration or burning of fossil fuels by decomposition of limestone. CO2 is released into atmosphere by respiration, burning of fossil fuels by decomposition of limestone. It is also produced during volcanic eruptions. It's a natural one. Then the percentage of carbon dioxide is around 0.03% in atmosphere. The excess of CO2 is being absorbed by the plants for photosynthesis. Higher concentration of CO2 means more than 0.03% in atmosphere. That causes global warming. So carbon dioxide released in atmosphere by respiration, burning of fossil fuels, as well as decomposition of limestone, is also produced due to the volcanic eruptions. And CO2 in atmosphere is 0.03%. And excess of CO2 gas is absorbed by the plants for photosynthesis. If it is more than the excess percentage, then it causes global warming. Now the hydrocarbons. Hydrocarbons are formed by incomplete combustion of fuel which are used in automobiles. Hydrocarbons are also gaseous pollutants and they are formed by incomplete combustion of fuel used in the automobiles. Therefore, finally, air pollutants are oxides of sulfur, oxides of nitrogen, oxides of carbon, as well as hydrocarbon. These four are air pollutants we have, that is gaseous air pollutants. Then coming towards global warming, or is called greenhouse effect. About 75% of solar energy reaching Earth is absorbed by Earth's surface, which increases its temperature. About 75% of solar energy reaching the Earth is absorbed by Earth's surface itself, which increases its temperature. The rest of the heat radiates back into atmosphere. Rest of the heat is given back to atmosphere. Some of the heat is trapped by gases such as carbon dioxide, methane, ozone, chlorofluorocarbons, compounds, that is CFCs, and water vapor. So some of the heat is trapped by gases such as carbon dioxide, methane, ozone, chlorofluorocarbons, that is CFCs, and water vapor. Thus, which makes atmosphere hot. Because of this, temperature will be increasing now. This is global warming. That is, the phenomenon where the atmosphere traps the heat of the sun and keeps Earth's surface warm is called global warming. The phenomenon where the atmosphere traps the heat of the sun and keeps Earth's surface warm itself is called global warming. And here, the carbon dioxide is a major contributor for greenhouse effect, or else global warming. If it is present more than 0.03% only, it causes global warming. Other greenhouse gases are methane, water vapor, nitrous oxide, CFCs, and ozone we have. So main global warming is carbon dioxide gas, a major contributor for global warming, or as greenhouse effect. And then other greenhouse gases are methane, water vapor, nitrous oxide, CFCs, and ozone. This is regarding global warming. Now coming towards effects of global warming. So effects of global warming, because of high temperature, the melting of polar ice caps and flooding of low-lying areas takes place, which results in the diseases like dengue, malaria, yellow fever, and sleeping sickness, etc. So because of high temperature due to the global warming here, the melting of polar ice caps and flooding of low-lying areas takes place, which leads to diseases like dengue, malaria, yellow fever, sleeping sickness, etc. This is regarding global warming. Then comes acid rains. The pH of normal rainwater is about 5.6, and this is because of combination of rainwater with carbon dioxide. CO2 is always present in the atmosphere. So the CO2 combines with water, the rainwater, and then gives rise to H2CO3. So therefore, you can say it is equivalent to 2H plus we have CO3 minus 2. Because of this, rainwater is going to be acidic in nature. So therefore, it comes out to be 5.6 because of carbon dioxide gas. If the pH of the rainwater drops below 5.6, then it is termed as acid rain. If pH is below 5.6, then it is termed as acid rain. Here, the presence of oxides of sulfur, oxides of nitrogen in the atmosphere due to the fossil fuel combustion and automobile exhaust cause acid rains. The presence of oxides of sulfur, oxides of nitrogen in the atmosphere due to fossil fuel combustion and automobile exhaust cause acid rains. These oxides combine with oxygen and water to form corresponding acids. Means sulfur dioxide, further oxidation with the oxygen gas and water will form H2SO4. Nitrogen dioxide, further oxidation and dissolving water, finally it is going to give us HNO3. These two are the reasons for acid rain. Here the pH value will be less than 5.6. Then comes, what are the harmful effects of the acid rain? It is harmful to agriculture, trees and plants here. It causes respiratory diseases in human beings as well as in animals. It affects the plants and animal life in aquatic ecosystem. It corrodes the water pipe because of acidic nature, resulting the leaching of heavy metals into drinking water. It damages buildings made up of stone and metal. Example is Taj Mahal is affected by acid rains. So acid rain is harmful to agricultural system, which is trees as well as plants we have. It causes respiratory diseases in human beings as well as animals. Plants and animal life in ecosystem is getting affected by that. Water pipes result in leaching of heavy metals in the drinking water. It also damages the buildings made out of stone and metal. Example is Taj Mahal is getting affected by acid rain. Then the particulate pollutants. These are the minute solid particles or liquid droplets in air. So minute solid particles or liquid droplets in air is called particulate pollutants. The particulates in the atmosphere there are two types, viable and non-viable we have. The particulates in atmosphere are viable or non-viable. The viable particulates are like bacteria, fungi, molds, which are dispersed in atmosphere. Now, the viable are bacteria, fungi, molds, which are dispersed in atmosphere, and human beings are allergic to these viable particulates. Non-viable particulates are classified according to their size and the nature. Non-viable particulates are classified according to their size as well as the nature. First one is smoke particulates we have. It consists of solid or mixture of solid and liquid particles formed during combustion of organic matter. Smoke consists of solid or else mixture of solid plus liquid particles formed during the combustion of organic matter. Dust is composed of fine solid particles over 1 millimicron in diameter produced during the crushing and grinding of solid materials. You can take sawdust from woodworks, cement and fly ash from factories you can take. So dust consists of fine solid particles may be produced during the crushing, grinding of solid materials. Say for example, sawdust from woodworks, cement and fly ash from factories we have. Other particulates are mist as well as fumes we have. So particulate matters, that is to smoke, then dust, then mist, then fumes are coming under non-viable particulates. Then smog. The word is derived from the two letters smoke and then fog. If you mix these two, you are going to get smog particles there. No? There are two types of smog. The classical smog, also called London smog. It occurs in cool, humid climate. It is a mixture of smoke, fog and sulfur dioxide. So London smog is a mixture of smoke, fog and sulfur dioxide. Chemically, it is reducing in nature. It is also known as reducing smog. So classical smog consists of smoke, fog and sulfur dioxide. It is reducing in nature and therefore called reducing smog. Next, photochemical smog occurs in the warm, dry and sunny climate. Occurs in the warm, dry and sunny climate. The main components result from the action of sunlight on unsaturated hydrocarbons and nitrogen oxides produced by automobiles and factories. That is, the main components result from the action of sunlight on unsaturated hydrocarbons and nitrogen oxides produced by automobiles and factories. Photochemical smog has higher concentration of oxidizing agents. Hence, it is called oxidizing smog. So, photochemical smog is mainly consists of nitrogen oxides produced by the nitrogen oxides and mainly contains the oxidizing agents in that. Hence, called oxidizing smog. Then, the effects of photochemical smog. The common components of photochemical smog are ozone, nitric oxide, acrolein, formaldehyde, peroxyacetyl nitrate, which is also called PAN, PAN. The common components of photochemical smog are ozone, nitric oxide, acrolein, formaldehyde and peroxyacetyl nitrate called PAN. It causes serious health problems. And both ozone and nitric oxide irritate the nose and the throat, and their higher concentration causes headache, chest pain, dryness of the throat, cough and difficult in the breathing. So that is, both ozone and nitric oxide irritate nose, throat, and higher concentration causes headache, chest pain, dryness of the throat and cough and difficult in the breathing. These effects of the photochemical smog. Then the ozone layer depletion, that is stratospheric pollution. Ozone layer depletion. The upper stratosphere has a layer of ozone. The layer of ozone protects us from harmful UV radiations coming from the sun. Otherwise, the radiations cause cancer, melanoma, it is humans, it causes cancer. So, upper stratosphere consists of ozone. If ozone layer protects us from ultraviolet radiations, if it is not there, we are being affected by skin cancer. Then, that is a freons. So, what is the causes of ozone depletion? It's mainly because of the freons. That say, for example, fluorochlorocarbons itself are called freons. So CF2Cl2, in the presence of sunlight, it forms CF2Cl plus 1 chlorine free radical. It can be CFCl3 also, presence of sunlight. This forms CFCl2 plus chlorine free radicals. So freons are giving us chlorine free radicals now. The chlorine free radical reacts with ozone and produces ClO plus O2. It forms now. Chlorine oxide is being formed there. It is also a free radical there now. The oxygen being formed in the presence of sunlight, it gives rise to two oxygen atoms now. Again, that ClO free radical which is being formed here reacts with once again another ozone molecule. It forms chlorine free radical plus gives rise to oxygen, means 2O2 molecules are being produced. The ClO can also react with O, the oxygen atom, and forming here 1 mole free radical and gives rise to oxygen. That way again we are going to get free radical there now. So this free radical formed can further react with 1 more ozone molecule. The process goes on continuously there now. So CF2Cl2 is giving us first of all chlorine free radical there. The free radical formed reacts with ozone molecule, forms ClO and O2. O2 again gives rise to 2 oxygen atoms are being produced. The ClO plus again 1 more O3 molecule, it forms again Cl radical and 2O2. ClO again, then oxygen atom produced here will form once again another chlorine radical. That way Cl radicals are being produced now. They further react with ozone molecule, it goes on now. And then it has been found that one molecule of CFC or as chlorine radical can destroy more than 1000 ozone molecules. It has been found that one molecule of CFC, that is chlorine radical, can destroy more than 1000 ozone molecules. Now, another important thing is pollutant is nitric oxide also causes depletion of ozone. The exhaust of supersonic transport planes introduce directly NO into stratosphere. The exhaust of supersonic transport planes introduce directly nitric oxide into stratosphere. The O3 gets depleted as shown in the following reactions, we can say. So the NO given by the supersonic jet planes reacting with O3, ozone layer there, it forms NO2 plus it forms O2. The O2 presence of again sunlight we have there, it forms two oxygen atoms there. The NO2 plus one of the oxygen atom reacting, it forms NO plus again gives rise to O2 gas. Again this NO, it reacts further with one more ozone molecule. The reaction continues now. So NO plus O3, finally you are going to get once again one more NO molecule forms. It reacts, the cycle continues now. In that way ozone layer gets depleted. So the main culprits are nitric oxide and then freons, which are decreasing the ozone layer. Next comes, what are the effects of depletion of ozone layer? Effects of depletion now. With the depletion of ozone layer, more UV radiations enter into troposphere, leading to aging of skin, cataract and skin cancer we have. The depletion of ozone layer, that is more UV radiations enter the troposphere, lead to aging of skin, cataract and skin cancer, etc. It is also reported that plants, proteins get easily affected by UV radiations, which lead to harmful mutation of the cells. The plants' proteins are getting affected, which leads to harmful mutation of cells. It also increases evaporation of surface water and decreases moisture content in the soil. It also increases evaporation of the water, of surface water, and decreases the moisture content in the soil. These are the effects of the depletion of ozone layer. Then comes second phase, which is called water pollution. After air, we have water pollution now. Let us see first of all sources of water pollution. Domestic sewage, discharge from kitchen, baths, lavatories is a domestic sewage. Industrial waters, waters from manufacturing processes, which includes acids, alkalis, pesticides, insecticides, metals like copper, zinc, lead, mercury, fungicides. So industrial waters, waters from the manufacturing process, which include acids, alkalis, pesticides, insecticides, metals like copper, zinc, lead, mercury, fungicides, etc., will give the industrial waste water. Oil, from the oil spills or washing automobiles, we get oil. Waste from fertilizers also, fertilizers plants also, such as phosphates, nitrates, ammonia we have. Waste from fertilizer plants, such as phosphates, nitrates, ammonia. These are the water pollution reasons. Then the cause of water pollution, organic waste. Other major water pollutant in organic matter, such as leaves, grass, trash, etc. This is also one of the major organic pollutant, leaves, grass, trash, etc. These wastes are biodegradable. These leaves, grass, trash are biodegradable. A large population of bacteria decomposes organic matter present in water. A large population of bacteria decomposes organic matter present in water. But there are some terms to understand. The amount of oxygen required by bacteria to break down the organic matter in a sample of water is known as BOD, biochemical oxygen demand. The amount of oxygen required by bacteria to break down the organic matter in a sample of water is known as biochemical oxygen demand. They consume oxygen, they consume dissolved oxygen in the water. BOD of water considered to be pure should be less than 5 ppm. And BOD is highly polluted water is around 17 ppm. BOD is less than 5, it is considered to be the pure water or else pure water. And if it is more than or around 17 ppm, that is said to be polluted water. This is regarding meaning of BOD. One more term, COD. COD, chemical oxygen demand, is a measure of all types of impurities present in water. and COD values include even COD values are higher than that of BOD values, because BOD talks only about the organic matter. COD talks about all impurities which are present in the water. So COD values are always higher than the BOD values. Then the phosphates and fertilizers, they are which are thrown into the water, they promote algae growth and reduce DO concentration of the water. This process is known as eutrophication. So fertilizers and phosphates, they promote algae growth and reduce DO concentration of the water. This process is known as eutrophication. The optimal value of DO for good quality water is 4 to 6 pm. Lower the DO, higher the pollution. Lower the DO, higher the pollution we have. Then fluorides. Fluoride up to 1 ppm makes enamel harder. If it is more than 2 ppm, it causes brown mottling of teeth. If it is more than 10 ppm, has harmful effects to bones. So 1 ppm is essential. More than 2, it causes brown mottling of teeth. More than 10, harmful to bones itself. Sulfates greater than 500 ppm will cause diarrhea. Nitrates more than 50 ppm will cause blue baby syndrome. Lead damages kidney, liver, brain, central nervous system. The metal lead damages kidney, liver, brain, and then central nervous system. Then comes soil pollution. Soil pollution, the sources are urban waste. The soil is uppermost part of the earth's crust. So urban waste will come in from urban waste. And agricultural pollutants are fertilizers. If at all excess use will cause fertilizing as a waste. Then pesticides. There are different types are there. Pesticides means insecticides used to kill insects. And examples of insecticides are DDT and BHC we have. Herbicides used to kill weeds. There the examples are sodium chloride and sodium arsenite are herbicides. Fungicides used to stop growth of fungi we have. So pesticides again are of three types we have. Insecticides, herbicides, and then fungicides we have. All are coming under agricultural pollutants. Then the industrial solid waste are biodegradable and non-biodegradable. Two types are there, industrial solid waste. Some of them are biodegradable and some of them are non-biodegradable. The biodegradable waste are generated by cotton mills, paper mills, food processing units, and textile factories. Biodegradable waste are generated by cotton mills, paper mills, food processing units, and textile factories. Non-biodegradable waste are generated by thermal power plants, iron and steel plants, and fertilizer industries we have. Non-biodegradable waste are given by thermal plants, iron and steel plants, fertilizer industries we have. Green chemistry is a way of thinking and is about utilizing the existing knowledge and principles of chemistry and other sciences to reduce the adverse impact in environment. Green chemistry is a way of thinking and is about utilizing the existing knowledge and the principles of chemistry and the other sciences to reduce the adverse effect in the environment. Let us now discuss objective questions from environmental chemistry. First question, stability of carboxyhemoglobin is? Stability of carboxyhemoglobin is? Comparing with that of oxyhemoglobin, carboxy is most stable. So option is A. So answer is option A we have. Next, when carboxyhemoglobin is about 3 to 4% in the blood, then it starts losing its oxygen carrying capacity. Implies option is B we have. When it is about 3 to 4% in the blood, it loses oxygen carrying capacity. So option is B. So answer is B here. Next, global warming is caused by, the main culprit is carbon dioxide gas for global warming. Along with that, CH4 is also responsible. So option is A we have. Global warming is option A. Then, due to the acid rain pH of rainwater, pH of normal rainwater will be 5.6, less than 5.6 will be acid rain. So option is A. So A is the answer for acid rain. Then, acid rain is caused by, it's mainly caused by oxides of sulfur and then nitrogen. So answer is C option we have. So answer is C. Then smog is derived from, smog is of two letters, that is smoke and then fog together is called smog. So option is A. So smog is option A. Pan is related to photochemical smog, which is actually peroxyacetyl nitrate. Peroxyacetyl nitrate is called PAN. Option is D. So answer is D we have. Then chlorofluorocarbons are also called, they are called freons or chlorofluorocarbons. Option is C. C option we have. Then ozone layer is decomposed due to fluorochlorocarbons. They are giving us chlorine free radicals. They are responsible for decomposition of ozone layer. So option is A we have, chlorine free radicals. Then the decrease, disease causing agents present in water, they are called pathogens. Pathogens are disease causing agents which are present in water. Option is C we have. Then which of the following is not considered as a pollutant, which is already existing in the nature, that is nothing but carbon dioxide is not a pollutant. So option is B we have. So B is not a pollutant. Lead is coming under air pollutant there. So it is an air pollutant, lead. Then fertility of the soil is mainly because of presence of minerals, itself is a fertility of the soil. So option is A here. Then so A is the answer. Then the non-viable particulates is nothing but dust particle. Remaining three of them are bacteria, molds and fungi are coming under viable particulates. Option is D we have. Then the species that is present in both mesosphere as well as mesosphere and thermosphere is O2+. Both meso and thermosphere will have O2+ in that. Option is B. Thank you.